Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Here we are, game number two now coming at you. As far as Evil Corporation versus Complexity, this is our first of two best of threes here today. This one, of course, being the loser's bracket round one matchup. And Complexity up 1-0 now going into the second game. Again, this is a team that had to come from the loser's bracket last cycle and did so and ended up winning it all. So trying to repeat that here. And already putting themselves in a pretty good spot to do so. But this post-patch play, first tournament matches since, and again, we are definitely seeing the changes here. Joined by Squeery once again of Revolution as my co-caster here. But welcome back, Squeery, and excited to see now what happens in this game here. And already not as crazy maybe as a draft here this time around, though, I feel like. A little more standard here in game two.
Yeah. Yeah, but we're going to see the Moira's change come into play right away. She actually got quite a huge nerf on the stun and the mana sunder.
Yeah, I'm looking it up right now to be certain. But yeah, she was one of the more wanting to be nerfed heroes coming up this patch and did so. So definitely... of significant, yeah, Shards of Harkon, yeah, at the earlier levels especially, got a little weaker, definitely. And as you said, the Mana Center is now purgeable. So, I guess that's not the craziest nerf by any means, but it gives people an option now to get rid of that, because damn, that could be an annoying ability to deal against. So, do you think that it is going to hurt her a lot, or you still expect to see her as a main support?
I'm honestly not too sure. I think Moira is more about, like, the Q nerf, the Shards of Harkon nerf, was pretty much just the damage at the early levels. So I think that's not going to hurt her too much, same as the Mana Sunder. I feel like it's just the hero itself is just more about the lockdown and the spells, not about the damage, really. But I'm not too sure. We're going to see it here. I think it's... Probably a good example of how the hero is going to continue in the future.
Yeah. I mean, for me personally, I still think her. It's what makes the hero is that E, the Ephemeral Forge, the illusion that she creates. It's still, as long as she has that, and you know the skill set stays the same, she's still going to be probably a pretty high priority, honestly, at least in my opinion. But and then her ultimate, of course, is always going to be a good ability to have. So. Personally, I still expect to see her quite a bit, as we do see here from Complexity. So, Tempest was banned initially, by the way, this time as well by Evil Corporation. It was Midas, Tremble, Tempest, and Clank. So, you see them respecting the what you got Tempest from last game, as he did have a high impact. So, is this going to be a jungle war beast now is my question here from Evil Corporation. Because of the jungle buffs, or should we still expect to see him suicide?
I think that's going to be Suicide. I mean, yeah. Zane, probably one of the best Suicide board beasts there is. And I would definitely love to see him more in the Suicide lane, especially with the bubbles being active early on. Could really benefit them. And then again, if you put War Beast in the woods, then Tidal is going to have a hard time getting her form.
Yeah. Okay. But yeah, if because of these changes, again, we saw the jungle changes last game. Pretty solid buffs, apparently. So, but yeah, I guess the suicide presence is maybe just a little too strong still to pass that option up. Madman coming out for Complexity. That's definitely a favorite hero of theirs. So, maybe not too surprised to see the Madman here. Gives him some physical damage as well to go with the Yogi. Good to see there. Did Madman get any changes? I don't think he did.
I'm not sure.
No, he did
not.
There
was something... Yeah, okay.
He did not. Good pickup, though. I mean, you like it?
Yeah, I'm personally a huge fan of the hero. It's a very nice hero overall. Really good in pretty much all stages of the game. And, yeah. If he gets a 1v1 matchup, which I think here he might... maybe against the bubbles, if they decide to pick another wooder, then, yeah, he's... Okay, interesting. But yeah, I think Batman is a decent pick here.
All right. So you say interesting, and does this... Okay, I mean, they're not ready to up just yet, so... I wouldn't be surprised if they're playing some mind games here, but again, Behemoth has potential to be a suicide. We know, so... It's either that or they run a dual support here. Maybe a tri-lane. It would have to be a tri-lane, right? I mean, they really don't have an option then. As there we go, the Legionnaire final pick. Okay. So, yeah, they're going to swap it. That's what I thought. Look at that. So Tankafet is going to play the Warbeast. So it is going to be a jungle Warbeast in the end. Coming out.
I see the same problem as last game, though, when they had the Legionnaire. I mean, where is he going to go once CDL has the Cleaver?
Yeah.
It's both of those heroes need a lot of space. They need a lot of space to form if they put in those kind of core roles. TDL obviously in the core role, but if Warbeast is in the set in the woods instead of the suicide, and he can't really form the enemy woods at all.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point, but they're going to have to deal with it some way, somehow. So, yeah, I guess, again, this is just another case of it's clearly the jungle buff's just a little too attractive to pass up here to send Warbeast into the jungle as a result. So, gonna go with that. They get the boots first on Zane here on Behemoth, who's running towards his top lane. He's trying to get that ward of sight down ASAP. He's gonna be spotted, though, it looks like. Oh, hold on, he's gonna scout. So it's not gonna be a free ward of sight here.
Oh, he's distracting him.
Okay. Yeah, nice, actually. They don't have a rev ward right now, so this is gonna be a... blocked pull camp. Unless, wait, does that block? Is it close enough? I guess it should be. I don't know.
Yeah.
I feel like it might be a little too far. I don't know if it
Yeah, it might not even be intended to block the pull.
Okay.
I don't have the indicator right now, so it's hard to tell.
Yeah. I see. Whereas, again, doesn't have a rev. She has 100 gold, so possibly could... You know, that is a cool thing I will say about the courier change done. I know supports can appreciate it, is that they don't have to worry about upgrading the courier anymore, which is pretty nice for them. So essentially saves them some 200 gold there. Not having to worry about that. They can spend elsewhere as the Hellhounds. Oh, the one is still... Oh, he lost aggro, though. No, he's coming back. And it dies.
He delayed them. Let's see what Ogi does.
What would you do if you're Ogi? Pull into the camp like he's doing, or... Oh, that's blocked.
I would pull it behind the tier 1 tower, in between the two towers.
Okay.
Then he wouldn't get any experience of them.
Look at that! He blocks him in, essentially. Drops into half life, even. Jeez. And eventually... Yeah, so I guess the pull didn't necessarily accomplish the most in the end there from Warbeast. So Ogi responded to it pretty well, but at the same time, Behemoth is now getting some experience, as you pointed out, because of where they are. So, but yeah, this ward of sight, it did not block it in the end. It just simply is for vision here. It's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
All right, well.
He found it anyways. Interesting. I mean, he knew that the pull is not blocked. And, yeah.
He's still... Yeah, that's... Wow. Good heads up there. To guess where it was. And now Behemoth is blind, as far as that goes. Again, now you see the initial stun. It's a little bit less time now, though, post-patch, so that's what you're pointing out. Not as much lockdown here. But I still think it's safe to say Moira is going to have a pretty good time, you know, boxing out Behemoth here, right? Like, Behemoth probably shouldn't do too well here at the top lane.
I don't actually think he's going to focus on boxing him out. I think, yeah, he's just trying to stack the woods, really, and get the pull off. Mm-hmm. I mean, Behe already being level 3, already having those boots, sure, you can box him out, but, I mean, if you box him out, you're kind of forcing him to roam, and that's probably not really what you want if you're on a Hellborn team. You kind of just want to secure your lanes, farm all of them. So, yeah, that's kind of the, yeah, that's one of the huge problems with Behin. If you force him out of the lane, he's for sure gonna get ganks off. So, yeah, it's just a matter of do you want him to gank or do you want him to be in the lane?
Yeah.
And complexity is doing the right thing, I think. I mean, not boxing him out too hard so he can stay in the lane while Ugi is free forming still.
Yeah. Well, makes sense there, definitely. So, sure, he's now even level 4. Geez, Zane is managing to get some great experience, I'll say that much. But as he pointed out, I guess at least he's not roaming around setting up kills. So, it is that trade-off there. That they're going for. But stacking the cans for what you got here on Legionnaire, and you do see his GPM starting to rise a little bit now, all the way up to 310 gold per minute. After he finishes these off, it's going to be upwards of 350, I want to say, even. As there's some bigger creeps, unless he dies, that would be bad. Fall back here. And he got pretty damn low, but he's good. Warbeast, how's Warbeast doing? It's still early on, so I don't want to judge too much, but oh, actually, he's going to be found by Madman here. He wasn't low enough to maybe kill him, but he's going to harass him a little bit. Cause some issues here, but looks like Warbeast is managing just fine, though, in the jungle currently. Do you expect Warbeast to be pretty well off here in the jungle, or is do you think that the Hellborn team is maybe going to address that and cause some issues for him, or should he get some free farm?
No, I think he will keep on free farming. I mean, it's just that the Hellborn team is aware that Legionnaire is going to farm way faster than the Warbeast in the woods. Especially taking into consideration that Legionnaire has his own like personal courier, and he can just ferry over potions all the time. So, yeah, that's exactly what he's doing. He's just constantly taking those stacks and getting potions.
You know, that's actually okay. Well, middle lane, by the way, Magmus, he's good. So here comes the roaming behemoth now at level 4. So now it's begun. He does have dust on him. See about perhaps ganking the madman with it at the bottom lane. It would be good against Magmus as well, of course, with the steam bath. But that's actually a really interesting point you bring up about the new courier system as well. That's not something I personally would have thought off the bat here, among several impacts that it makes, but how, as like a jungler now, as you point, you could just now ferry regen constantly to you, so because you're not worrying about, you know, taking the courier from others constantly. So I assume that's what these junglers post-patch are definitely taking advantage of, and Warbeast in this case doing just that. So I'm glad you brought that up, basically. That's a good point. Oh, bottom lane, Oscar goes down. I did not catch that as I was watching the top lane, because yeah, they're trying to gank Behemoth right here. But he is going to be fine in the end. But I don't know if you caught that, but
no, I was actually
yeah.
looking top as well.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Madman goes down, and Darklit, I guess, with the Dark Blades, maybe just underestimated the damage there, perhaps.
Yeah, and Darklit is definitely one of the better heroes to deal with a Suicide Madman. Just not being able to get the stock off is pretty huge for Madman. So yeah, nice rotation. And yeah, that's kinda what the Hellborn team just has to worry about, dying in the early game.
Not what they're looking for, but doing so right there. It's again only 1-0 though currently. They did push the top tower as kind of a response there, you could say, as Ugi up here at the top lane, and they were trying to gank Behemoth but weren't successfully able to do it. But hey, they'll take the tower kill. Just fine with that. Ugi is up there at 440, but again, look at Legionnaire, man. Holy crap, 460 gold per minute. I know Legionnaire's always been a pretty damn good flash farming jungler, but Jesus, he is just both of these games today. Different players, in fact. Madman, by the way, bottom lane again. This time they dive in pretty aggressively, and dust from Warbeast obviously helps with that, too, to chase him down for the kill. So good play coming out from the Legion side, and well, not dying is not happening so far for this Hellborn side. Speaking of that, though, look at that. What you got is charging in middle, decapitates Bubbles, and runs away with the haste rune. So good aggressive play coming out from him in the meantime. On some high
yeah.
farm here.
That was very well played. Waiting for the Bubbles to use his Trail Surf and then just running in with the Haze, and pretty much nothing Bubbles can do there. But yeah, I'm surprised Magmus is managing that well against Bubbles mid.
Yeah.
Didn't definitely expect then.
You'd expect Bubbles to win that matchup there?
Maybe not win, but definitely have more form than a Magmus.
Yeah, no, most certainly Magmus has the higher creep farm, and now the kill on top of that, at least the assist, that's big, and 370 gold per minute to show for it. But I don't know about you, but so what are your thoughts on this Legionnaire, again, now back-to-back games in different players' hands even, just doing very well? Is this, did you kind of expect this yourself, or is this even higher than you expected, or better?
That was one of the, like, main concerns that we, like, the competitive players had with the Courier and Woods change, the Legionnaire. It's just, yeah. I mean, 470 GPM right now, and that's just pretty much because he can, yeah, get those HP pots whenever he wants to.
So, my question is, why do you think Legionnaire isn't as worrisome as a Zephyr? Because they both are the similar idea, where they're both excellent flash farming junglers with a stacked camp. That's essentially what they're both great at. That's why we're seeing this excellent farm here. I understand they're two different heroes, where Zephyr's obviously a lot more magic focused, and Legionnaire, of course, more physical. But, I mean, do you see what I'm saying? Like, is there a reason why people are so adamant that Zephyr is just way too strong when a Legionnaire essentially does the same thing early game?
The problem is that Zephyr is going to farm out super well throughout the entire game, and it's more of a carry hero compared to the Legionnaire that, you know, farms good early on and then tries to get those ganks off and slows down a lot in farm.
Yeah.
And yeah, Legionnaire is just, as I said in last game, is kind of the all-in hero. You jump and you can't, like, there's no way out. Okay. And Zephyr is more of the carry hero that is really hard to bring down with a lot of damage. So yeah, I do understand why people are complaining about the Zephyr.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Fair enough there. Legionnaire now, he actually, he's going a slightly different. You saw Tankafel last game, he went with the Striders, actually. What you got insisting on going the Ghost Marchers here? Do you think it's just maybe a preference base, or do you think one is better than the other?
No, I think it has a lot to do with the Legion heroes. I mean, he's playing against the TDL and the Warbeast, and if he's not able to run away from those, which he wouldn't with Striders, then he's pretty much dead. Ghost Munchers give him the kind of edge that he can run away or live a bit longer and buy more time even. So yeah, gotcha. Definitely like the decision there.
So this is what we're kind of talking about with the Warbeast jungle. How now Darkly has already started to come into the jungle a little bit. Obviously has the bottom tower already killed. Doesn't have the Rune Cleaver just yet, but it's coming. I think she... No, she probably still needs both broadswords, actually. I think she still needs both of them, so... A little bit off of it, but still getting coming pretty quickly here. But yeah, that Warbeast, his farm is going to be impacted at least a little bit, you would think, in terms of the Dark Lady kind of swapping over to the jungle now. So, as I said, I mean, Warbeast, so for the time being, is still 325 gold per minute, so... Not doing too shabby here. With that
I feel actually like he's been slowed down. I don't know by what, but I feel like he should have more form at this point. Or like a higher GPM.
Yeah. Maybe not comparable to a Legionnaire, but just a higher at least.
No, definitely not, yeah, but higher.
Oh, middle lane, actually. They're looking for a kill on a Magmus. A Fuzzy Sloth, he stuns in, actually. Legionnaire comes out the portal gate, gets the decapitate. Are you kidding me? What an escape from Magmus there. Even got an eruption out of it as well from Zane. And it ends the one-for-nothing exchange right there. A lot of action happened. Only ended up being an Andromeda kill. But, yeah, that was huge for Magmus. How did he live? Jeez.
That was pretty much a misplay by Bray. He decided to not use the silence, so Magnus could stun away. And yeah, now even they used to be here ulti, so they have to dodge fight for another 100 seconds now.
Yeah. Ogi, he's cleaning up triple stack Ancients. in the meantime. So it's, you know, last game he was had a little bit of a struggling start, but definitely recovered in the end, of course. This time around, it's just good from the beginning. And we are witnessing that. Again, he is going to go the icon here to follow up, of course. As there we go. He has enough for the B-star now. So going to sit on the ring of the teacher. Build Rock coming in. Oh, boy.
Yeah, they have their PKs. They know they can force or get ganks off now. Ooh.
Yeah. Moira went the wrong way. If she went to the right, that was a dead Dark Lady. Right there. Oh, meanwhile, actually, speaking of Dark Lady, they jump Madman. And look at that, Oscar. He's going to go down. I mean, that was honestly a pretty good play. Heads up from the Legion side, but...
they're going to pay.
Maybe. He's going to go in and taunt. He's trying to bait. He knows that he has take cover and everything, so... it's not guaranteed. Okay, he's going to go for it right there. Magma stuns in. Now, there is support nearby, but it's just so quick. That's a level 2 decapitate. It's, what, 450. That's right, 450 life, and you're dead. And you see Bubbles. That didn't take much effort to get to that, yeah. So...
I actually think he was initially out of vision, because it's nighttime and you don't see as much. So,
oh, good point.
So I think that's why he didn't jump initially. Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, bottom tower now going to be easily pushed in. So, man, Dark Lady actually still doesn't have the ring cleaver. I thought she would have had it by now, but 14 minutes in, and I mean, she's farming 400 gold per minute, so it's not like she's doing bad farm, I guess. It's just, I guess I expected it to be on her by this time, but still needs a couple more creep kills here to have it. Now, normally the Abyssal Skull would follow up a Rune Cleaver, I feel like, on a Dark Lady, but of course they have one on War Beast already, so what do you think? We just go with a Firebrand to continue to be greedy, or what?
Nah, I don't think there's any way he's going to get a Firebrand. I think he would go for the BKB.
Okay.
Like, they're not going to get enough space for War Beast and him to farm anyways, so... and I think Complexity picks, like, they should pick up on that and force fights, mm-hmm. or pressure them. And, yeah, Imbabai knows that, and he's definitely going to go for a BKB, or I hope so, at least.
Okay. Yeah, you know, you were mentioning that last game quite a bit about Complexity, and they seemed a little more passive than perhaps they should have been as far as trying to push at times when they had more of an opening. But, you know, in the end, it obviously worked out, but still doesn't mean that... perhaps should have taken advantage of those opportunities. So you're addressing here. Dark Hoodie, man, he's actually getting pretty aggressive here. He just got the Rune Cleaver. Oh, this could be a big kill, actually. Legionnaire is going to be jumped. Taint Soul, you see, can he get the swap off? He's just out of range. He swaps in for the Kamistan. Well played.
Yeah.
Here gets the kill. Oh, Madman, in the meantime, this fight's not ending just yet. Magma and Oogie are collapsing now. Oogie is out of mana. That could be the big no-no right here. In jumps Behemoth. Down goes Madman. And Oogie now actually in trouble as well. Promise Torch goes up, though. He will not survive, however. Going down as well. Magmus falls. What a fight here for Evil Corporation. They take it to them, and they come out on top here in the end.
Yeah, Peak Yon Zane. Definitely a huge impact there. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, if that wasn't for a Legionnaire using his Ghost Mutters when he was trying to farm, he definitely would have gotten away. And then the fight may have looked a bit different.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not often you see a Dark Lady get a Rune Cleaver and then look for kills. But that's exactly what Imbaboy did right there. And, hey, it worked. So it's hard to say anything was wrong there. So, you know, is it just me, Squeery, or... both of these games now, I'm looking at these GPM charts, and it feels like there's just more gold in the game.
There is definitely more gold in the game. I mean, how to explain it? You can kill a camp at 58 and then just go out, and the creature is going to spawn again.
Yeah.
That's, yeah.
Okay. So, so you think that it's just really that, and that's what's making the biggest difference here?
Yeah, definitely.
Xander gets caught. Okay.
I mean, especially those support kills, the gold and experience gain from that is nerfed kind of huge. So, yeah.
Yeah.
I believe it was nerfed. Yeah, but it should be.
I know, again, there were changes to normal and casual mode, and obviously normal mode is the one that we care about, where the golden experience, the numbers were changed in a couple places. I think actually overall it was actually supposed to be a buff in terms of the amount of gold and experience that players would get. So I think it's safe to say obviously that is having the impact too in terms of the higher numbers that we have here. But top lane Warbeast. In the secondary tower. Jeez, the complexity not addressing that there. It's a free tower kill, so good news for Evil Corporation there. Also saw Warbeast, by the way, as Madman stalking in. Man, he's going to find Darkity, actually. Now, will this result in anything? Behemoth, the Fissure Stun. Here comes Oogie, though. Cover of Darkness. Magma stunned in at the last second, though. Oogie's close enough. He had the Cover of Darkness on him, but it didn't matter in the end. And down goes Darkity. That's a big pick, of course. For complexity.
Yeah, nice find by Oscar.
Warbeast, he actually went Puzzle Box. What is your take on that?
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense against Magmus and Madman especially. Magmus obviously with the... Magmus usually wants to use the Steam Bath in a fight to just get his cooldowns off, and a Puzzle Box can you take you off guard fairly easily. And yeah, it's just a really, really good item against Madman because of the mana drain and Oogie.
Yeah, this is big Magmus. He got silenced. He came in to stun, but the silence from Pubbles was exactly at the right time. Oogie goes down. They do get the response time on Behemoth, or response kill on Behemoth, and it looks like that will be the end of it, but man, yeah, that silence, if it wasn't for that, I think Magmus would have stunned, and Oogie may have actually been able to Primal Surge and try to turn it right there, but in the end, he could not. So Warby's still pushing top. He bought the Puzzle Box. It's not on him yet, though, and he's actually going to ulti for him. He's going to try to run away now, and I think he should be fine.
Yeah, he should. Yeah, he's fine.
Yeah, he's going to keep going here, so he'll be good in terms of getting away. But, yeah, he actually, there we go, even another purge. I want to say that's now a level 2. See, that's actually a downside now. I'm realizing I probably need to address this. Is I'm trying to click on the couriers to see what's coming out, and you can't do that anymore. So don't know what's being sent out to certain heroes, unfortunately.
Yeah, maybe that is something that's going to be able to be fixed in the future.
Yeah.
Maybe allow specs to... you know, hover over it and see it or something.
Yeah, I'll bring it up, yeah. That's definitely something I'm realizing here, so. Anywho, Oogie. Look at this, by the way, from Oogie. Going an icon into a Shrunken. That's not his typical choice. But he likes the Shrunken here. You think, is that something you agree with?
He definitely needs it against the BH-TDL combo. I mean, TDL silence is so good against Oogie. He's not going to get a single spell off if the TDL is on him. And yeah, Behe obviously just pretty much killed him in 2 fights in a row, so yeah, picking up on that and trying to avoid them.
See Dark Lady right here, clearing out the Ancients and continuing her top 5 in the game now, nearly 500 gold per minute. Again, Imbaboy had a very successful Bushwhack game last time around though too, and ultimately came up short in the end, so. Bushwhack tends to be a very hard carry, as is Dark Lady. Point is that it's not guaranteed as bottom lane. They're pushing this tower. They know some... I thought they were going to jump down here, it felt like. But never mind. Bubbles, shell surfs, and then runs with the portal key. So that's going to be a tower kill for them. Meanwhile, you see Warbeast at the top lane. It is a level 2 puzzle box here. He actually is not spawning it here. Curious about that, but he's just instead going to beat on the tower. Maybe wait for a fight to break out. Spawn them. Oh, he does it right there, actually.
Magnus, you're stunned on Creepstone, so that's not going to happen.
Oh, yeah, the Arcane Vortex in the background and everything. But couldn't follow it up, but they're going to follow up this, actually. That's a quick kill on a Behemoth, so they do catch somebody out of it. That's good for them. Got to say, Legionnaire this time around, he's actually... again, Tanka fell last game for Evil Corporation. It seemed like he did scale off as the game picked up as far as farm especially, but what you got's managing to keep it up pretty well. 440 GPM. At about 22 minutes in here, Warbeast. Oof. He's going to make the getaway. As he TP's out, but...
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like also the Legion team is playing way better than last time. Like, this time they really know that they can split push super well, and they're doing it. They're dodging super hard. And Hellborn team initially was pushing bottom, but they didn't even get the tower. While they had a Legion team, got the middle, tier 2 tower.
Oh, right, yeah. Yeah, now that bottom tower is definitely still up, so... Unable to push it. I guess they don't really have the greatest sieging team. Oogie's, of course, not really great at that at all. Being the whole magic immune thing, so... That's, maybe makes for the reason of not getting that tower either, but... Yeah, the split push clearly proven to be an issue. I mean, I guess they need more farm at Oscar, it feels like, on this Madman. They need him to have a pretty big presence here in this game. And right now he's not doing the greatest, but the Shrunken Head is in the works at least for him. Oh, Legionnaire? Yep, he's going to die here.
Asking myself why he's in their woods when everyone off the Hellborn team is pretty much on the enemy's lane.
True.
But... Yeah, it's getting caught, and yeah, I mean, Legion team is just playing way better than last game, it feels like.
That we also saw the some synergy there. By the way, Zane going post-haste, he didn't even mention that, but he gets the post-haste, and then he actually ported onto the Hellhound there to assist for the kill, so some nice synergy. And a good reason to get post-haste here on the Legion side. So, Complexity.
Yeah, smart.
Oh, nope. Not going to happen. You know, so it does feel like that the Legion team is actually in a pretty good spot here. Evil Corporation, they got the top farmer in Dark Liddy. They've been split pushing well, but I mean, Golden Experience right now says this game is very even. Do you think it is, or are you leaning towards the team here?
I think Legion has way better team fight right now. I mean, the Behe is going to have so much and the base tower goes down. I mean, that is ridiculous.
Magmus, oh, that was a miss. Devil the Behemoth, he's here for the counter, and no, Warbeast is going to fall too many spins, and Magmus stuns in to secure the kill on Behemoth, so a double tap coming out right there. It almost worked out. You can tell Warbeast was second-guessing himself. In the end, he stuck in there with Behemoth nearby, but just came up short with the damage output. So good hold from Complexity. They did lose a tower, as you pointed out, but they get a couple of hero kills at least.
I mean, they can't do that. They can't go push against the Warbeast TDN. They're just going to split push their base. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's not going to work. They need to find something else. Like, they should probably go Kong right now. Push out top lane and go Kong.
Well, they're going for Kong instead right away. But that's a good point, because now the top lane is basically at the base with no tower there. So they do have to be concerned about that and actually being pushed in, but...
Warbeast is dead, though, so he would have to make his way all over there.
Yeah. It's a little too far. So, not killing at the quickest, though. You see Madman, they don't really have the greatest tank, I guess. Or I feel like they should, but they just have too much melee, I think is what it is. And Madman keeps dying right here. As getting low. Oh, my god.
They don't have the damage for it.
Yeah. Madman's just not tank. They don't have lifesteal right now, do they? Yeah, I think that's it. That's the biggest issue. That Madman usually relies on having some kind of lifesteal with the Abyssal Skull at least, but he kept having to go in and out in that Congor. So
yeah, I also feel like they should get an Abyssal Skull here. I mean, they have 4 melee heroes that all would kind of benefit from the aura. So yeah, would definitely like to see that if. Foreign Mist decides to not go for the gnomes.
That's actually a good point as well. You know, we were having the conversation earlier. It's actually maybe a catch right here. Oh, Bubbles just in the right position. Behemoth may be spotted here, but Magmus, another portal key up in 6 seconds. Just not going to be in time, so he'll have to fall back and defend top lane as a big creep wave coming in. Oogie does just that. But yeah, good point being brought up about the gold and how feels like there's just so much gold in this game. There is, but and another reason for that actually is yeah, we talked about the changes, been a lot of changes, and one of the other ones was the creep wave spawns. It's now you get an extra melee minion sooner now, as well as the range creep comes. Everything comes a little bit sooner, basically, throughout the game as far as when they spawn the extra creep in the creep wave. So, you know, that's just another thing that adds to maybe a little bit more gold consumption in the game. And takes place here as Warbeast. Uh-oh, he's caught by the Arcane Vortex. Oogie is nearby, but the ulti form, I think, is going to easily allow him to live. Maybe not, though. He's stuck around. And now he's in trouble. In comes Behemoth, though. That's why he's stuck around. But it's not going to be enough again. It comes up just short. What is Warby's doing? I guess he's just trying to hide right here. And he ends up going down. Oh, boy. That's the second time they tried for that play, and it just has not worked out.
Yeah. Yeah. They get the tower meanwhile, but, yeah, definitely not the kind of turns you want if you were Behemoth.
Good kill right there. Good catch from Complexity. And you mentioned, though, Dark Liddy is continuing to push, or was continuing to push in that bottom lane, however, as actually going to be spotted by Moira, but we'll get away with ease here. She has a Frostburn, by the way. I haven't really kept an eye on that too much, but now checking on it. The Rune Cleaver into Shrunken, so it did go that, of course, is the follow. As you were stressing, then with the Frostburn, and now another 2,200 gold, so... She's definitely getting pretty big right here. What do you think her next item should be? The Wingbow, perhaps, or what?
It could be a Wingbow, but I think Magman is still pretty far away from the Bastion, and you kind of only need it against the Magman Bastion. So I would actually love to see something like a Bastion herself, maybe on TDL. That would be pretty decent against the... Yeah, pretty much against everyone of the Hellborn team. It's pretty much his final item. I mean, he still has one more slot after that, but yeah, I gotta make a decision there, I guess.
Well, that's interesting, because I feel like, though, if he would get a Brutalizer, he might be just better off getting a Savage Mace, right? Where, sure, it's more gold, but with the way he's farming, he shouldn't have an issue getting that, so... Do you agree with that? Do you think the Savage Mace actually would instead should be the option over Brutalizer? Or is there a reason to get a Brutalizer over a Savage Mace, other than it's being cheaper?
Yeah, you have more lockdown. I mean, it's a 1 second stun compared to a 0.1 second stun, I think.
Okay.
And that plus the synergy on TDL, where you pretty much just run at them and the enemy has to run away. It's pretty much it's like a really good combo, especially against a hero like Madman. I mean, if he can't move, then he's dead. He relies so much on his mobility. Same with the Legionnaire and Magnus.
Yeah,
it's probably not gonna have too much effect on Ugi as he is so tanky. But yeah, I still think it's a really good item.
Couple of others. You Frostfield played an Oogie, but you see the Assassin Shroud on Dark Lady, yeah.
Yeah, interesting.
Interesting as in you're not a fan? That's what I kind of got.
Nah, it's... Taking Juro is definitely a really strong item on TDL.
Okay.
I just feel like... Yeah, I didn't see that coming, at least.
Alright, well... Imba boy, going the assassin shot here. Eventually they can Jiro, of course, as you pointed out. But had to get step one first. A good one at that bottom lane. No, Madman just a little too far. Ain't gonna be fine here. He's level 16 now and trying to work on the Brutalizer. But once he gets a Brutalizer, that as well as a Shrunken Head is obviously a very good combo to have for him. And he actually will start being a pretty big presence once he gets that combo here. In these fights, of course. But yeah, as we also mentioned, though, Frostfield plate yet again on Formless here. Getting some big armor. Helps survive, but also the nice mana pool.
So the problem I have with the Madman right now is that Zane has a... Oh, that was fast.
That'll happen.
Is that Zane has a puzzle box. So even if Madman gets a Brutalizer... If Tankafet just runs at Warbeast, as Ugi goes down top lane, he Madman just has to run. I mean, he can't man up. His special is not going to come into effect. So, yeah, I'd really like the puzzle box now even more on Warbeast.
All right. Yeah, you know, I was thinking about that too. Obviously, Alchemist Bones against a Parasite especially. Pretty good pickup because of the puzzle box too. But, you know, knowing that they've been going up against puzzle box for a little bit, do you think Alchemist Bones should be something here that the Hellborn team prioritizes, or he's fine not seeing it yet?
They haven't really felt it, I think. Like, they haven't really felt the puzzle box to work in those fights.
Okay.
So, I don't think they're paying too much attention to it, really, at this point. And they're soon going to be at a point where they don't really care about the puzzle box anymore, because it's only going to take effect on the Madman.
Yeah.
And I don't think they care enough about Madman to invest 2k gold on one of their heroes.
Well, down goes Congor right there for the Legion side. You could tell Complexity definitely knew something was up, but they scouted a couple times, but obviously just could not feel comfortable making the initiation right there. So in the end, the Token of Life now on Dark Lady, who just got the Genjiro finished as well. I believe I just saw Spell Shards purchased by Zane, so that's going to be coming out now. He, of course, got the Storm Spear Portal Key here on Bubble, so definitely a lot of items coming together here now for Evil Corporation. And setting themselves up for a pretty big team fight coming up here, probably top lane, of course, with the tower already dead. Sheepstick on a Magmus, however, in response here. There's the Brutalizer on Madman. So at the same time, Complexity has definitely managed some pretty good pickups themselves. Moving along into a fight here as, again, Moira. It is just so much for her, especially. Two hits and basically dead, so. Madman will be fine, however. Ooh, that was close. Almost got it in time.
It's also the power of the Genjuro on Tiriel. She just roams around and, yeah, can pretty much kill everyone if they're alone. Such a strong hero at this point. Mm-hmm. And I don't really see the Hellborn team dealing with the TDL. I mean, yeah, they have the Sheepstick and the Basher now. But are they going to be able to lock him down enough to kill him twice with the token?
Well, you see, I mean, hell, he's just going to charge in pretty recklessly right here, it feels like, as Taunton tells him to come into the base, but not going to happen, and we'll be fine there. So really not a huge deal. It was a shrunken in on Legionnaire, though, so... That's not going to be down. But, yeah, I mean, it's already tough to kill once, let alone twice. But then you got a swap on top of that. You got the Storm Sphere from Bubbles. You got the Counter Drum from Behemoth. He's been on top of those. So, yeah, this really is going to be a tough task for sure for Complexity in terms of holding here.
Why are they not pushing, though? I mean, Legionnaire BKB is down. Yeah, I feel like you should have pushed top. That was pretty much a free Rex.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. Well, no, 2.5 minutes on the Dark Lady token. I mean, there must be an item that they're really waiting for, but it doesn't. No, they already have everything, right? So I don't see why they did either. That's a good point. They're just gonna let Legionnaire get the shrunken head back up, I guess.
Yeah, make them feel comfortable again.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe they just wanted to use the token to get more map control.
Kind of doing that here, but you know what they're doing here, they're split pushing a bit, but this is giving Complexity an opportunity to maybe get a jump on one or two of them, and could be pretty disastrous, honestly. In fact, Dark Lady's going by herself to the bottom lane here. Oh boy, there's the swap, however, Dark Lady, she gets Sheepstick though. They need to chase her down. They're going for Andromeda. Oh, boy, they really missed an opportunity there. Meanwhile, the top lane Madman, he's gone by a couple. He's actually going to survive initially. Now Dark Hood is even coming back in. This just feels so weird to me. Fuzzy Sloth is going to come in and secure a kill on a Zane. However, now Warbeast is going after the supporting cast. Again, Dark Hood is not here, so they are taking advantage of her being by herself in that they're going for the others around her. Meanwhile, Eruption coming in, but the Portal Key from Bubbles is going to be fine. So they got 3 kills for the one on Madman throughout all that exchange there. So, I mean, that was Complexity actually coming out on top here.
Yeah, I don't understand anymore.
Yeah.
This is just so weird. What is evil corporation doing? I mean, why would you go for the bottom tower? I mean, the alone.
Yeah, I don't.
Yeah.
That was weird. I don't really understand. And usually Evil Corporation, if anything, they are a team that seems like they're pretty on top of, making correct decisions, but that seemed like it wasn't. And it seemed like it was just odd on both sides. Like they were split pushing like they were and setting themselves up to get caught in one place or the other, which has eventually happened. But the bottom lane, I felt like they really actually could have tried for something on a Dark Lady there. But they probably, to be fair, they probably thought backup was nearby because maybe they didn't see the Legion team at the top lane. They were still hidden, and that's why they were playing it so defensive. But if they actually went all out on the Dark Lady, they probably would have killed her. And sure, she would have had a buyback, but it could have been big. But again, they still came out on top. That's the good news for Complexity. As Evil
Yeah.
Corporation now. Won't have a token, but they have another 5,500 gold on Dark Lady. So she's going to be getting her next prime item here. Whatever it may be. Okay. Rift
Okay.
shards.
It's very greedy.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's gonna have plenty of damage, but now he doesn't have a buyback. He doesn't have any survivability besides the BKB. Yeah, if they catch him, they very likely lose their Rex.
Well, that's getting is that level 4? It is, yeah, you got the full level of it. Holy crap.
Actually, never mind. They still have outer towers left. And no way Hellborn team pushes any fast.
Oh yeah, there's still too much to deal with. It's definitely gonna need to be a couple of 1-5 tier for complexity somehow to start pushing back. So yeah, again, the lead only says it's about a 5,300 gold lead, and the experience is practically even. It's seems like it's been like that for a bit, but from what we can tell, it definitely feels like Evil Corporation, of course, is pretty far ahead with how the game is playing out here. But it's still definitely a chance, of course, for Complexity. They win one and two fights, then all of a sudden they could be counter pushing here.
No.
Uh-oh.
At the entrance, yeah. That's gonna.
Oh, well, they'll take Andromeda. Will they go for Dark Lady? No, they will not. Again, they play it
Oh.
safe. As the Kelp field gonna be wasted there.
I think they could have killed the Elder as well. If Ugi would have moved earlier from mid, they could have definitely had to kill there. So making bubble space his ulti is also pretty nice.
I feel like they're constantly playing like the whole team is right behind Dark Lady. And again, we can't see we can see that that's not the case. It's actually Warby. He's going to be caught. Your post is coming in. Whoever that is has Sheepstick on a Dark Lady, by the way. They kill Magmus quickly. And they are going to scare off the rest of them. So that post is coming into play right there. But I was gonna say, Complexity, they feel like that there is a lot more backup nearby when obviously we can see there's not. But again, they don't have that that god vision that we have. So just playing it very scared and very safe, and that is Complexity's style in the end.
Yeah. I mean, Formus is buying his items, so he's not saving for a buyback. Looks like the next fight is gonna, yeah, decide the game. Or, well, if Legion wins, then it will be over. If everyone wins, then it's probably gonna be a way to go.
Yeah. You see Abyssal Skull in the works for Madman. He's trying to get there. He does have the Ring of the Teacher now, which is good news, but I stressed earlier that that'd be a pretty good pickup here for him and this Hellborn team. Legionnaire, he's developed pretty nicely as a Shrunken Head. So his Bulwark, Deagle the Barbed Armor as well, so potentially can be pretty big against the Dark Lady if she's not careful, actually. Solid pickup
Yeah.
there.
Yeah, I'm usually not the biggest fan of Barbed on Legionnaire, but against TDL it's pretty strong. Also against Behee, when he tries to counter-initiate and pretty much kills himself because he deals so much damage.
Oogie the Sheepstick, it's coming along. Only has 6 charges on the icon, so hasn't necessarily snowballed with that. But Complexity, they're playing it again very patient here. They're just waiting for somebody to go a little too far and then catch them. And it's worked a couple times so far, to be fair, so can't blame them for going that style as middle lane. Whoop! Love gets picked off. They're kind of using him as the decoy here. Seeing what's up. And ends up dying as a result yet again. Only 4 deaths, though, so there really hasn't been that many.
No, felt like it should have been more.
Yeah. Dark Lady just got her post-haste, actually. She's having it delivered, so she'll now have that opportunity.
I guess they're just waiting for another Conger and then trying to make something happen. Just feel like that's one Kong too late, but yeah, it's up now, so they're gonna take it right away. Or are they? No, they are.
Yeah. God. Those crits, especially when they happen, just drops Conger. Yep. Zimora's gonna make it take as long as possible, but I don't think they're defending this in the end. Well, maybe, actually. They are making their way out here. Again, they're blind to it right now. But they feel it's happening and gonna group up off to the side. The Hellhound coming in. It's gonna be spotted. Are we gonna see a jump? Dark Eddie's back and forth, back and forth. It's coming. Something's gonna happen here. Here we go. They're charging in the shockwave. Not the greatest placement. Coming to the back with cover of darkness. No doubt doing work as well. Magma's dead off the bat. Oogie trying to do what he can, but they're just all dead. I guarantee you the crits doing work throughout that fight. Double tap for him, my boy. And here they're pushing into the base. You see GG being called though. It's Complexity. They finally gave it a shot here to fight head on, and that was not gonna happen. Too much fighting power from Evil Corporation. So we got a game 3 now coming up here. But your final thoughts on that game 2, Squirry?
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like Evil Corporation played way better this time. I mean, yeah, they did some mistakes and maybe they could have ended the game a bit earlier, but they still played way better. And yeah, it's going to be interesting how game 3 plays out.
Looking forward to it. It's been a very entertaining series so far, and here we are, the loser's bracket. Again, the loser of this, they are done here for Psycho number 2, finishing 4th place. The winner going to the loser's bracket finals to stay alive and play tomorrow. Complexity doing the road and the trip last cycle, ended up winning it all. Trying to do it again, but right now Evil Corporation in their way. And also trying to do the same thing, of course. Anyways, guys, we got game number 3 coming up next here at 1-1 Series. Stay tuned. We'll be back here on Hauntcast. Haunt Tour Season 4, Cycle 2 playoff coverage coming at you.
Shit!